Good to see everybody here today. Welcome to this service. We're going to praise the Lord today for His Word. Would you please stand? And let's do that now. A little bit more on my keyboard if you could.
Excellent word. What more can He say than to you He hath said? To you who for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with thee, O be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and will still hath leaned for repose. I will not desert to His foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. Jesus, You're my firm foundation.
That this morning we can not only stand upon the rock, but we can stand upon the Word of God. And every word in the Bible is true, from the first word to the last amen. He wrote it for us as an instruction guide, a roadmap to how we live to please Him and how we live as Christ. I love the red letters. I love the black letters. I love every letter of His Word, and I'm so thankful that the Word of God is something we can stand upon.
Let's sing it. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound
with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope. In this world, where'er we roam, ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words age came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words. Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall Savior's love for me. My Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior.
About this,
when with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me, singing how shall ever be.
just the voices.
Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Amen. Amen and amen. You can have a seat. This morning, our men are prepared. We're going to be taking an offering this morning, and I just wanted to tell you a little bit about what my morning has been like. We've been looking forward to this day when we would do flip-flops, and I've been praying for you as I've been praying for me. And this morning, in my quiet time, God reminded me that He told us that we're supposed to pray for our daily bread. Now, sometimes I think I can do my own daily bread, don't you? But God wanted us to remember that we are dependent upon Him for everything. And that's why we pray for our daily bread. Just like we need to be dependent upon God for our daily needs, we're dependent upon His needs here at church too. I'm asking you just to continue worshiping with me this morning as we prepare to give our tithes and offerings. Father, what a great song to sing right now. Just thinking that it's going to be our joy to sing through the ages about what You've done for me and how You've given us an opportunity, Father, to partner with You here so that we might tell others about Your love for us. What a great joy that is. So, Father, as we prepare to give, I ask that You just bless the gift and the giver, Father, that we might be able to tell Your story far and wide throughout Panama City, Father, throughout all this region, throughout the world. I pray that You'd give us, Father, a platform that we'd be able to do that. Not because of us, Father, but because of You. And we continue just to be amazed, Father, that we can depend upon You for each and every need that we have. Father, would You now give us ears to hear Your word? Father, Your word is truth, and we want to hear it today. I pray that You'd give us hearts that are ready to receive that truth so that we might follow You fully all the days of our life, that we might be the obedient people that You want us to be. I pray all this in Your strong name. Amen.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but You have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle. Your promise still stands. Great is Your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in Your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. And my heart will sing Your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail me yet. You never fail me yet, and I never will forget. You've never
Great is the faithfulness of our Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord today. Praise Him in this place. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Do you know you are an incredible group of people? Amen. I had an amen out right out of the center in the first service, you know. Amen. But you are, really. Because it's been just a short time before we shared with you the thought that we needed to go to two worship services and to two small group hours. And you have accepted that so readily, so quickly. You've been so warm-hearted and your spirits have been so cooperative. And I know that's just the Lord living inside of you. And he's the one that has made you that way. But I just want to thank you and let you know how grateful that I am for your wonderful spirit of cooperation and grace. Now, I'm eager to begin this new series with you of what good is good doctrine. For the next 8 weeks, I plan to ask and answer that question. You know, I don't have to tell you, we live in a culture that doesn't care very much about doctrine. They think of doctrine as being rigid and academic. But folks, the word doctrine simply means teaching. And when we talk about Bible doctrine, we are simply talking about what the Bible teaches, but especially those principal ideas that we find repeated time after time again throughout the Scriptures. And it's my hope that in this series that I can show you some of the very practical applications of these teachings of Scripture. Let me tell you, good doctrine is far from being a treatise about how many angels can sit on the head of a pin. Yeah, good doctrine is a very practical and useful instruction for us on how to navigate life. And aren't we doing a lot of that these days? Just trying to navigate life. I mean, we are walking down new paths. We are going to new places. We are doing things that either we've never done before, or maybe we've done something similar before, but we were thinking, I'm never going to have to do that again. And here we are. And I thought in that last song that began, I thought this wall would fall by now. I thought about how many walls I've seen driving around Panama City. I thought that wall would fall by now. But I'm sure there's walls in all of our lives, you know, that we thought just might come crumbling down in what we have experienced. But we have always found God faithful. So let's take this first one. What good is the doctrine of revelation. Now, first, get this. Folks, the doctrine of revelation is not about the end times, okay? I know the book of Revelation is all about the end times, but the doctrine of revelation is different. The doctrine of revelation seeks to answer these questions. How can I know the truth about God? How can I get past my friend's opinion or the writer's opinion? Or how can I even get past my own opinions? How often do you hear people say, well, my God is da-da-da-da-da, like their God's different than your God or somebody else's God? How can we know the truth about God? How do we know what God is really like? How do we know what God has said in times past, his actual words? And how do we know what God has done? How do we know what God is doing today? How do we know what God has promised he will do in the future? The doctrine of revelation answers those questions. Now, if this doctrine gives an answer to those questions about how you can know for sure what God is like, how you can know for sure what he has spoken, how you can know for sure what he's doing, would you not agree that is good? Hello? There's nobody back here to ask. I'm asking you. Would you not agree? That is good. I mean, that is grand. Not just to have an opinion, not just to have an idea, but to know for certain what God is like and what he has spoken and what he is doing. That's nothing short of miraculous. I have trouble thinking of a word big enough to describe how really wonderful that is in my life. And the only word that comes to mind is supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. I guess it's the longest word I know. So what is this doctrine that makes such bold promises? It is beautifully described in Psalm 19. And as we read, you'll note that Psalm 19 is broken into two parts because there are two parts to this doctrine. So we'll read them separately and talk about them. First, part one is in verses 1-6. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utter speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There's no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of heaven, and its circuit to the other end, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. Folks, God reveals himself through his creation of this entire universe. Sometimes people call this kind of revelation of God's person general revelation, because it's available generally, and it tells you some general but very important things about God. But it simply refers to what we can know about God just by looking, just by observing the things that he has made, by observing his creation. Now, folks, with the naked eye, we can see plenty of the grandeur, the majesty, the beauty, the complexity, and the order that God has put in creation. But we are privileged, actually, to live in an age where we are not limited to seeing just with the naked eye. But instead, we have the telescope that extends our vision outward and the microscope that focuses our vision inward. With the telescope, we can see the magnitude of God's creation, and that the order that we observe here upon the earth extends all the way up into the heavens. We see the universe is filled with galaxies. Folks, not just filled with stars, filled with galaxies like our own Milky Way. Each one has its own uniqueness, and yet each one testifies of the consistency of their design and of their operation. And then within each galaxy, there are solar systems that revolve in elegant patterns, and within each solar system are planets and moons and asteroids and meteors, all that rotate and revolve with intricate symmetry. And the microscope reveals more again. Looking at the structure of living beings fills our mind with wonder and with awe. Folks, have you ever looked at the pictures of a living cell? It is a mini world, all of its own, just inside a single living cell. You know, every cell has an exterior membrane, But this membrane is not just a shell, because the membrane of every cell allows certain things to enter that will extend its life or help it accomplish its purpose. And yet that same membrane will be an impenetrable barrier to anything that would bring it harm or would hinder the purpose for which it is in the body. The cell continually remanufactures its own parts that wear out. Now, wouldn't that be nice? It metabolizes its food. It discards its own waste. And it does all of this while performing the function for which it was designed. For instance, your red blood cells that are flowing constantly in the blood of your body, they're not only just busy living, surviving, that they may exist another day in your bloodstream, but they have the particular function of being able to gather oxygen and to transport that oxygen, like from your lungs all the way down to your big toe, so that the cells in your big toe will not die. And the cells do all of this as a kind of harmonious concert, with each cell like an individual instrument contributing to the whole of sound and the work of the body. And they work in harmony with each other by what is remains yet a only little understood means of chemical communication. Now, how do these things tell us something about God? Well, the complexity and the order of the creation tells us there has to be a God. There just has to be a God. The created order tells us that God exists, and it tells us that He is incredibly powerful. Everything that we see around us testifies of a creator. You know, there is an argument that no one denies. Now, some will deny it when they're talking about religion. Some will deny it when they're talking about philosophy. But I'm telling you, this is an argument that nobody denies in their everyday living, thinking, and conversation. Let me illustrate what I'm talking about. Suppose you unearthed an ancient axe with a wooden handle, a stone blade, even the remnants of cowhide that tied it all together still remained. Among the many questions that that might raise for you would certainly be this one. Who made that? I mean, anybody would ask that question. The staunchest atheist would ask that question. The most strident evolutionist would ask it. The most learned skeptic would voice the same. They all ask the question because they know. They know design comes from a designer. Folks, let me tell you. Somebody dug up an axe like that, no one would theorize about how the rock was randomly chiseled by wind and rain. No one would hypothesize how that handle was a mere circumstantial branch that just fell in the right position, shaped and suddenly attached to the stone. No one would waste any time wondering how those strips of hide jumped off the cow and tied it all together. Folks, everybody would consider the presence of the axe as definitive proof of the presence of a man who made this simple tool. In fact, evolutionist anthropologists, when they are going through strata and they find in the midst of some of the strata of the rock some simple tool That to them is enough evidence to say at this time there was Homo sapiens. Homo sapiens were there because they know somebody had to make the tool. Even if they don't find any bones, even if there are no footprints or any other evidence, the tool itself tells them, because innately we all know design means there was a designer. Do you get this? I mean, this isn't rocket science, folks. You understand this? I mean, isn't that how we all think? Isn't that just life? We see things that exhibit complexity and symmetry and order about them, and we always think somebody made this. Now, because every person knows in the depth of their being that design comes from a designer, God has built in the most infinite, magnificent design that is possible in everything that is in the universe. I don't mean in some things. I mean in every single thing that God made. God left his fingerprints all over it for us to see that it is the evidence of design. Somebody made it. So listen to David's conclusion again. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament, which also means the heavenly expanse, the firmament shows his handiwork. Now, the next words of this part that I read at first sometime proved to be a little confusing. So I want you to just listen to them carefully, and then I'm going to come back and just give you the sense of what David is saying out of this. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them, he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of the heaven, its circuit goes to the other end, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. David is saying all of the heavenly bodies testify that God made them. Their testimony goes out day after day and night after night, revealing the knowledge that God exists. This testimony transcends every language, and it is heard through the whole earth. Doesn't matter who they are. Doesn't matter where they live. Doesn't matter if they speak one of those languages that has not yet been learned or understood by another person except those in that people group that speak it. This transcends every language. Everyone can see his handiwork in what he has made. The testimony that God created the heavens goes out faithfully, just like the sun rising in the morning and setting in the evening. And as the rays of the sun warm the bodies of every man and woman upon whom they fall, the testimony of God's creation warms the heart of the person who will see it to say, there is a God. Folks, the way God has revealed himself through creation tells us something very, very important. It's something I hope you'll remember sometime when you're down, sometime when you are discouraged, sometime when you, you feel like you've kind of lost your way, remember this. And if that doesn't happen to you, and I hope it doesn't too very often, remember it for somebody else that you care about where that's happening to them so you can share that with them. But the way God has revealed himself and what he has made in his creation shows us that God wants every person to know him. Every person. God has not hidden himself. He wants to be known. Listen, when on the best day of my life, when I come to a point and I say, you know, I just want to know God more. You know, Paul was like that. Paul, you think, who could know God better than Paul? But Paul said, I want to know him more. I want to know him more and more and more. And so on the best day of my life, when I'm imitating Paul as he imitated Christ, and I say, I want to know him more. This truth reminds me. The only reason I do not know him better is not because he is hiding, but because I am not seeking. God wants to be known. He wants every one of us to know him in all of his completeness. And so, he has not only made himself known through his fingerprints on creation so that everybody in all the earth can know that he exists and that he's powerful, but he has taken a second step to reveal himself because he wants us to know more than that. He wants us to know that he exists, he's real, he's powerful, but he wants us to know more than that. So God revealed particular information about himself. He revealed what his character is like. He revealed his purposes, what he is accomplishing in making the universe. He has revealed his standards. He has revealed his activities. Students of the scripture often call this special revelation, because God has revealed specific information about himself, more than just the general thought that God exists and God is powerful, but he has given us very specific information about himself. So how has he sent this special revelation? Again, David tells us in the second part. He said, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. And the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More are they to be desired than gold, even much fine gold. And sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. And moreover, by them your servant is warned. And in keeping them, there is great reward. Now, as you can tell from the multiple references that David makes in this passage, he's talking about the Bible. And folks, the Bible is more than just a record of revelation. The Bible is itself revelation. Peter said, listen, no prophecy, that means no declaration of Scripture, ever came by the will of men. Men weren't just giving what they thought to be right. Men weren't just giving their opinion, even learned opinion. No prophecy came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Today, the Bible, this written revelation. And folks, it doesn't matter whether you have it on printed paper that you carry around or you have it on your phone or some other device. It's not the matter on which it was printed. The Ten Commandments started out on stone. How'd you like to carry the whole Bible like that? So it doesn't matter in what way we carry it, in what way we store it, on what device that we read it. It is the very words of the scripture that constitute the revelation. But the Bible is the only means by which we can know any of the specific things that God has revealed about himself. Folks, now understand that. The Bible's not just the best way to know about God. It's not just in the top three. The Bible is the only way that we can know the truth about God. The Bible is the only way we can really know what he's like. It is the only way that we have a revelation of who God is, what he has said, what he's done, and what he is doing. And this revelation is a completed revelation. In fact, most of you know, in the very last book of the Bible, in the book called the Revelation, God warns us. He says, don't you add a word to what I've given you. And don't you take away a word of what I have given you. There will be serious consequences. And it is a purposeful revelation. We saw that, did we not, in studying through the Gospel of John? You remember the purpose of the Gospel? It's the same purpose of the entirety of Scripture. John said that these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the... Jesus is the Christ. And believing, you might have life in his name. That's the purpose. And that is the revelation, the whole of the revelation of the scripture. That is its purpose, that you may come to know the Son of God, Jesus Christ, that you may believe that he is the promised Messiah, Savior, and believing in him, that you may have life eternal and abundant in his name. And it is a sufficient revelation. In fact, Paul wrote to his disciple Timothy, and he said, Timothy, understand every word of the scripture has been breathed out by God, and he has breathed it out so that you can be a complete man. It's profitable for everything you need, Timothy. Therefore, learn the scriptures, because God has given it to make us complete. And here we see the third very practical application of this doctrine. You see, the fact that God has given us a complete and sufficient revelation of himself, he has done this that we may know what is right. I don't mean we can make a good guess about what is right. We may know what is right. Last week we talked about how Jesus spoke to the disciples, called out to them when they were fishing, and he said, cast your net on the right side of the boat. And I pointed out then, okay, so what's the left side of the boat? It's the wrong side, and so's the front side, and so's the back side. The right side is the one that God tells us to take. Folks, God wants us to know the right side. Now, we live in a world that is working very, very hard to convince us that there is not a right and wrong. There is just your opinion and my opinion and somebody else's opinion. And that all of them are equal in their value. They're all equally valid. And we just have to accept all of those opinions. And yours is as good as mine, and mine is as good as yours. God says, I want you to know the right way. Every other side of the boat is the wrong side. He said, I want you to know the right side. So God, in revealing his character, revealing his purposes, revealing his actions, revealing his standards, tells us what is right. Folks, you know, even those of us who are Christians, when we make wrong choices, when we make wrong decisions, you know why? It's either because we don't know his revelation well enough to know what he tells us is right in a particular area. And that's often the case. But if we do know his revelation well enough that we know what he says, then we make a choice not to obey him. But it's always one of those two. Either we don't know what he says, or we choose not to do what he says. I did this from my earliest days in college and stayed there about 7 years before God brought me out. I remember the first weekend I came home from college, I about scared my poor mother to death. Come home Friday night and we'd gotten up together and we're sitting at the kitchen table having breakfast. It's just Mom and I in the room. I don't remember where Dad was at the time, but it's just she and I. And I said, "Mom, let me ask you a question. If you were able to count all the kinds of animals that existed in Noah's day, and you computed how much space it would take to hold all those animals, and then you took the measurements of the ark that are given to us in the Bible, and you computed the volume of the ark, and you saw that the computation of two of every kind of animal would not fit in the space of the ark," said, "would you still believe the story in the Bible of Noah and the ark?" And she said, "Well, I guess I still would." And I said, "I wouldn't." Her eyes got about that big. And I said, "You know, I've decided," this is after about 4 weeks of education, I said, "I've decided that we need to trust Jesus as our Lord and Savior by faith. But everything else needs to be proven." Well, that was the early days of what was a spiritual pit in my life for the next 7 years. A time when I was going to college and even in the first part of seminary, when I was supposed to be learning the Word of God, but I was learning it more from a perspective to challenge it and doubt it and question it than from a perspective of allowing it to speak to me and reveal to me what God says is right. Now, God delivered me from that by a challenge raised by a teenage girl. So you teenagers never underestimate your influence and what God will be doing in your life. But her challenge led me to a study of the first three chapters of Genesis to study whether that was believable. Now, I will tell you, when I began, I already had the answer, and it was no. But I did the study anyway, and over the course, what I discovered was that evidence that came from the fields of physics and biology and the understanding that came from the mathematical field of probability convinced me that the evidence was in favor of the account given in Genesis 1 to 3 being true over the prevailing theory of evolution. And though I came to that much against my will and against all of the teaching that I was presently encountering in college, I can tell you it didn't take very long for me to make the next step to say, if Genesis 1 to 3 is true, the whole Bible is true. And I came to a place where I could join with the Savior in saying what he prayed for us right before he went to the cross in his high priestly prayer when he was praying for those of us who would believe. And he said, Father, sanctify them. Make them holy. Give them the right way. That's what that means. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. And I came to the place that I could say with Jesus, your word is truth. Folks, you see, God's revelation of himself in the scriptures always shows us the right way. And that's why we need to read it. That's why we need to study it. That's why the first purpose of our Life Change group is to study the Word of God, because God wants us to know him. God wants us to know all about him, and out of that to show us the right way, not only to think and understand, but the right way for us to live. But that means we have to receive the revelation. And we have to believe the revelation. That's one of the reasons that our first purpose for our small groups that we call Life Change Groups, the first purpose of those is to study the Word of God together, because it is the Word of God that reveals that to us. And my question to you this morning is, from where you are right now, what do you need to do to better receive or to more completely believe what God has revealed about himself and about the way that he has shown us that is right? Would you just stand with me in prayer? Just bow your head, and I'm going to ask that no one move yet. If you need to leave early, there'll be a minute which you can do that, but right now, would you just bow your head and just stand before the Lord? I want to just ask you a few questions that you're not answering to me, but I want you to realize right now, would you actually answer them to God? Would you just speak out of your heart to God and tell him where you are on this? First, I want to ask, do you believe the testimony of creation? That God exists, and that by his infinite power, he made it all. Do you believe that? Or have you been swayed by the world to just think it all happened by random chance, by processes partly known or unknown? Do you believe the testimony of creation? Secondly, I want to ask, do you believe the testimony of Jesus, who said, Father, your word is truth? Do you believe that completely about the scriptures? What do you need to do in your life to better receive this revelation? What do you need to do to more faithfully believe this revelation of God? I hope all of you that are in this place have come straight from your small group, where you've been with another group of people studying the Word of God, and I know many of you have, but maybe not all of you. And I encourage you to get in a small group, and in a little bit, when we dismiss the service, some of us pastors will be hanging out down here at the front. We invite you to come and talk to us, and one of the things you could come and say is, I'm looking for a small group. And we're familiar with most of the small groups, and we can help identify one that will probably be right for you, at least a good place to start, and we'd help you with that. But if you're not in a small group where you're actively studying the Word of God, you're not receiving the revelation like you ought to, because you can't possibly be learning all about it just on your own. And then let me ask, There are some of you here today that need to trust Christ. The number one main purpose for which God sent the revelation of himself is that we may believe that Jesus came as the promised Messiah and Savior. And that believing in him, trusting in him, we may have life in his name. If you've not done that, but you're thinking about it, come and talk to one of us pastors here. Just let us know where you are, what you're thinking about. Let us help you. Let's pray for you, pray with you. We want to help you come to faith in Christ. There's some here that are not a part of our church. Listen, it's important to be in a church where the Bible is taught and preached and where you're among fellow believers who are striving to live it out. Now, folks, we have not arrived at that. Not a one of us. We're all still walking the path and working on the journey. But we're striving to do that. And we invite you to come and strive with us in living out the Word of God as well as in learning it. Now, what answers have you given to the Lord? What do you need to do? Just tell him. Father, how we thank you that you are not hidden from us at all, but by your own initiative and out of your great, marvelous, infinite, matchless love, have chosen to reveal yourself. We stand aghast that in light of all of your revelation, in some ways we remain so ignorant of your person. Forgive us. Forgive us. That you would send the word from heaven to tell us what you're like. And we won't take the time to pick it up and read even a chapter in a day. That you would tell us all we need to know about what is right. But we won't bother to study it or to learn it. Help us, Lord, to see what we need to do, how we need to respond to this magnificent truth in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let me close with one last sentence. If you will study this revelation from God, if you learn all that's in it, there'll still be questions people will ask that you will not be able to answer. But you'll be able to answer all of the important ones. God bless you.
Amen, church. As we are heading out this morning, I just want to encourage you, if you are not a part of a small group this morning, there'll be some people at the welcome desk, and then we'll be down here front. If you don't even want to talk to anybody, that's fine. We have little sheets here that will kind of explain the age groups, and kind of you can kind of pick for yourself where you want to go. But if you want someone to talk with you about Life Change Groups, we can do that. So, church, as we go out, one of the things that we need to be encouraged about is that through Christ in us, we are able to reveal Christ to the people that we come in contact. So as the psalmist says, as David says in Psalms 19, let the meditations of our hearts and the words of our mouth be pleasing to you, O Lord. And God's people said, amen. Have a great day.